So yesterday we discussed what are the important steps that we needed to follow in order to activate a microcontroller. We saw there were five steps. Of the five steps, four were electrical in nature. What were the four electrical requirements that we discussed yesterday? First one was the power. The second one was the reset circuit. The third one was oscillator. The fourth one was the firmware locator. The job of the power is to provide constant 5 volt for the microcontroller. Reset will initialize the microcontroller. Oscillator will provide clock pulses for the operation of the microcontroller. And firmware locator will locate the firmware. It will tell the microcontroller from where the firmware is available. So these are the four electrical requirements that we discussed yesterday. The most important requirement which will actually make a microcontroller to perform or to work is the logical requirement. Logical requirement is the way of adding intelligence to the micro. So you can add intelligence to the micro by virtue of developing a source code. You can do that by using an assembly language programming or by using embedded C. So today's class, we will see the logical requirement or the firmware development part. Of course, this is also we have discussed in the class, but then considering your I am not very convinced that most of you are comfortable with this. So I'm just spending some time in reviewing this as well before we move further. So today's class is about the firmware basics. How do we add intelligence to this microcontroller and make this a smart IC? When we buy a microcontroller from a manufacturer or from a vendor or from a shop, that is a dummy IC. Only when you write a code to it and add intelligence to it, it becomes a smart IC. So let us see how do we add intelligence to the microcontroller by writing a piece of source code today. Before we move further, it is necessary that we need to understand what a special function register is, SFR. SFR stands for Special Function Register. Special Function Register is nothing but a register that is present inside a microcontroller which has the functionality of performing a unique operation within a microcontroller or to control a unique peripheral inside a microcontroller. There are 21 such special function registers available in 8051 microcontroller, classified into the following categories: parallel port operation. There are four special function registers available: timer operation, you have let us analyze what are these: port 0, port 1, port 2, and port 3. And for timer, it is TL0 and TH0, TL1 and TH1, timer mode, and timer control, T mode and T con. So totally 4 plus 2, 6 SFRs we have in this category. And then the third category is the UART operation or serial communication. You have serial buffer, SBUF, and SCON, serial control. We have two here. And then interrupt operation, you have two more. Interrupt enable, IE, and interrupt priority, IP. We have two more. So if you add up this, you have 4, you have 6, 10, plus 2, 12, plus 2. Total adding up to 14. So 21 minus of 14 gives me 7. This 7 is my miscellaneous SFRs. Are you with me? Are you able to hear my voice clearly? Yes. Because of internet connectivity, I wanted to double check this every time. So whenever I'm asking this question, please reply me. Right. Now, out of the 21 SFRs, we have 14 of them going for the four major operations. The rest of the 7 include one accumulator, one B register, one stack pointer, one power control SFR, PCON, one data pointer. This fellow has two components, data pointer higher byte and data pointer DPL. This is DPL, data pointer lower byte, data pointer higher byte. And then we have a program status word or processor status word, PSW. So let us count how many of them are here. One accumulator, this is this can also be referred as ACC. Accumulator 1, B register 2, stack pointer 3, power control 4, data pointer low 5, data pointer H 6, and program status word PSW 7. So totally 7 plus 14 already adding up to 1421. So these 21 SFRs are totally controlling the operation of the microcontroller. Some of the SFRs are dealing with parallel port operations. Some of the SFRs are operating or using or controlling the UART operation. Some of them are controlling the timer operation. Each SFR is dedicated with a specific functionality, and some special function registers are meant for general purpose operation, just like your PSW. Program status word is not meant for a unique application, rather it is used for a general purpose processing application. Similar is the case for stack pointer. Stack pointer is meant for stack related operations. Accumulator is taken a general purpose register used for all mathematic, arithmetic and logical operations. So these are the SFR types. It is very important for you to understand the important SFRs in any microcontroller. Understanding the SFRs is very important to understand and take control over any microcontroller, which means understanding these 21 SFRs will enable you to control 8051 microcontroller. just like this, as simple as that. So if you wanted to understand and control 8051 microcontroller, it is necessary that you understand all these 21 SFRs one by one. Some of them we have already seen in the class, some of them we are yet to see, but if you are in control of all these 21 SFRs, you can actually control the entire 8051 microcontroller. Let us move on to the firmware basics. This is the basic 8051 program. You know very well that this is the header file. Ash include register 51.h. This is function prototype. This is the header file. This is the function prototype. This is called the global declaration area from here to here. From here to here, it is called global declaration area. Global declaration area is used for three purposes. First purpose is to declare function prototypes. Second is to declare global variables. Third is to declare S-bit variables. S-bit variables should also be declared in this global declaration area. So this is the three major use of the global declaration area. Then comes the main function. This is my main function. Within the main function, whatever you declare becomes a local variable. This is a local variable because this variable is accessed within the main function and it cannot be accessed anywhere. Whereas a variable declared in the global declaration area can be accessed by any function. So this is a local variable. And as usual, any microcontroller program has an infinite while loop, while one loop. Within the while one loop, you put the application code. Here goes the application code. And any function you want to use, you need to define it separately. So functions has three places. One is a function prototype. The second one is function definition. And the third one is a function call. Function call is the actual place where we use the function. So this is a small skeleton of a basic embedded program, which you must be already aware of. Coming back to the data types, we use unsigned character and unsigned integer data type. Unsigned character ranges from 0 to 255, totally giving you 256 combinations. Unsigned integer data type takes from 0 to 65,535, giving you 65,536 combinations. Floating point data type we never use just because it is a memory hungry data type. It takes more number of bytes because our RAM is very limited. We have only 128 bytes of RAM. So we are not, we are not having a surplus memory here. So there is no point in taking this floating point data types into our microcontroller program. So we limit ourselves only to unsigned character for any number between 0 to 255. If the number exceeds 255, then go for integer data type, only these two. Then we have two single bit data type that we have discussed. One is called an SFR bit data type. This is called an S bit data type. The fourth one is a bit data type or a Boolean data type. You know already what is the syntax for declaring an SFR bit data type. What is the syntax? S bit. What is the name of the bit assigned to port N? Port N cap bit number. Example, S bit motor is assigned with port 2 bit 2. So this is the syntax. This 2 refers to port number. This refers to pin number. So this is the third data type, SFR bit. The fourth data type is the bit data type. The bit data type is used for declaring a single bit value, 0 or a 1. Here, if you define bit my value can either take a 0 or it can take a value of 1. Because it is a bit value, bit variable, it can either accommodate a 0 or a 1. If you assign my value equal to 20, the compiler will not give you any error, but this is a totally ridiculous assignment because you cannot assign a value greater than 1 in a bit data type. But the compiler will not give you any error. So make sure that you are using these data types carefully. So this is the fourth data type. So we saw only four data types. One is unsigned character. Second one is unsigned integer. Third one is S-bit data type. S-bit data type is used to assign names for the port pins. That is the general use. Fourth one is a Boolean data type, namely the bit data type. These four data types are good enough to deal with almost 90% of applications in AD51. Very rarely we use floating point variables. Even if we need floating point operations, there are ways of getting around it without using floating point data type. We'll see that later on. Next comes the conditional statement. We use a simple if structure. So this is a basic syntax of a basic if statement. If the condition is true, do this. Second one is in if else structure. If the condition is true, do this. Else, do something else. This is an if else construct. The third one is a multiple if else construct where you have multiple conditions. If condition one is true, do this. Else if condition two is true, do this. If none of the condition is satisfied, do this. This is a multiple if else structure. These three structures are good enough to make very complex decision making in embedded C programming. So you need not have to, you know, go for any case structure or something. Though you can, but then let us not complicate things. Let us limit ourselves to the simplest of all, which is a simple if structure. The next one is a while loop for doing certain operations again and again. First one is an infinite while loop, which we'll use in the main function. While one, whatever you put here is executed indefinitely. This is an infinite while loop. This infinite while loop is used invariably in the main function of all our programs. The second type of while loop is doing something based on a condition. While ti is equal to 0, I do this. Which means as long as ti is equal to 0, execute this. This is similar to this. When you have nothing to execute, it is better that you put a semicolon at the end of the statement. While transmit interrupt flag is equal to 0, do nothing. This is a do nothing loop. Do nothing means I simply keep waiting as long as ti is equal to 0. The moment ti becomes 1, this condition fails and it goes to the next statement. This is another version of while loop which we use very often. And this is a conditional while loop. This is the conventional while statement. While you have a condition, as long as the condition is true, this is getting executed. So these are the three variants of while loop. The first one is an infinite while loop, which will always get executed. The second one is a waiting kind of a while loop, which means a do nothing while loop. I'm expecting something to happen in near future. So based on that condition, I'm just going for a wait. If that condition never happens, it becomes an indefinite wait. Okay. There are situations which may happen. Probably if you experience in embedded programming, then you will understand this. I'll give you a typical scenario like this. For example, I am having a 8051 microcontroller here, 8051. I have an ADC here. So the 8051 fires the start of conversion first, SOC. So the ADC starts the conversion process. It takes the analog input and then it converts the conversion process. And the ADC is supposed to give the end of conversion back to the 8051. So what the 8051 does, the 8051 will wait for end of conversion to happen. How it waits for the end of conversion to happen? Like this. While end of conversion EOC is equal to 1, I keep waiting here. What it means? If end of conversion EOC is equal to 1, it means the ADC is busy. If end of conversion EOC is equal to 1, that means the conversion is over. So what am I doing here? I am going for an infinite waiting loop, waiting for end of conversion to become 1. Waiting for end of conversion to become 0. Sorry. It is currently 1, which means the ADC is busy. Once it becomes 0, it means the ADC has completed the conversion process. Now, let us say for a hypothetical situation, I forgot to power the ADC. I have not given the power supply pin, or I have not connected 5 volt here, which means the ADC is already dead. But the microcontroller is active. But I forgot to power the ADC, which means the ADC is not functional. But I assume in my code, I fire the start of conversion from the ADC, and I am waiting for the end of conversion to come from the ADC, which will never come in this case, because the ADC is already dead. The ADC is not going to give you end of conversion because I have not simply powered it. So in this case, what happens if I am going to go for an infinite loop, waiting for end of conversion to become 0, that condition is never going to happen. This is called a single point trap or a single point failure, which very often you will face if you don't deal the hardware properly. If you are going for a while loop expecting something to happen, make sure that something happens. In this case, that something means the end of conversion from the ADC. If that something doesn't happen, that is where the microcontroller gets stuck and it will never come out of that. So at this point, you have to be extremely cautious. The third flavor of the while loop is the conditional statement. As long as the condition is, this is a conventional while loop. As long as the condition is true, the body of the while loop will get executed. These are the three flavors of the while loop. Next one comes the for loop. For loop, you have a do nothing for loop. Do nothing for loops we use normally for creating software delays. For I equal to 0, I less than 25,000, I plus plus, I do nothing here. This is called a do nothing for loop. The other way of writing this is putting a semicolon at the end. For I equal to 0, I less than 25,000, I plus plus. If I put a semicolon here, that is equivalent to putting a do nothing parenthesis. Both are same. So we use do nothing for loops for creating delays. The other one is we use for loops for iterating a block of statement fixed number of times. For I equal to 0, I less than 1000, I plus plus, acquire data, delay 1 second. In this case, I'm acquiring 1000 samples of data because this loop is going to get executed 1000 times. 1000 times this block of statement will get executed. Every time I'm giving a delay of 1 millisecond. So we use for loops for two occasions here. One is a do nothing for loop for creating software delays. The other one for iterating fixed number of times a block of statement. One thing that you have to understand very clearly with regard to for loops is where to put parenthesis and where to put, where not to put. For I equal to 0, I less than 10, I plus plus, delay 1 millisecond. So below this for loop, you have only one statement to get executed. In this case, there is no need for you to put this parenthesis. Even if you put parenthesis, there is nothing wrong. Okay, so if you have only one statement below this for loop, this parenthesis becomes optional. Whereas if you have multiple statements, send UART. So if you have more than one statement, then this parenthesis becomes important. So I would say you always use parenthesis below for loop. It takes away this discussion. Whenever you use for loop, use parenthesis, irrespective of whether you have only one statement or more than one statement. There is no room for error straight away. Okay, so that is something which you can keep in mind. Okay, so this is regarding the basics of the firmware basics, which we already discussed. So with this very minimal amount of information, it is good enough for you to deal with any complex application in embedded C programming. So I am assuming that you are with me. Let us now move on to the basic parallel port operation. So as of now, all of you are following what is going on here. Okay. Now we will move on to parallel port operations. Okay. If you take any microcontroller for that matter, any microcontroller, any XYZ microcontroller, you would be interested to know, or you can master this particular microcontroller if you know all these four. One, the pin details. Number two, the activation circuit. Number three, how to deal with parallel ports. Number four, how to take control over timers. Number five, how to use communication. When I say communication, there are, when I mean serial communication, there are lots of communication available. UART, I2C, SPI, so on and so forth. For 8051, only UART is available. And the last one, how to manage interrupts. These are the six information that you need to learn for any microcontroller. If you know these six features of that particular microcontroller, then you can obviously design any complex application using that particular microcontroller. So as far as 8051 is concerned, I think we have learned the pin details and we have also learned the activation circuit. Today I'll introduce you something regarding the parallel port operation and take it forward. Okay, let us complete the core concepts first before we move on to the next stage. Programming parallel ports of your microcontroller. First, let us understand what are the special function registers that are concerned with the parallel port operation. There are four special function registers: port 0, port 1, port 2, and port 3. All the four SFRs starts with 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. This 0th bit is called the LSB, or least significant bit. This 7th bit is called the most significant bit, MSB. Are you able to understand? So all the four ports work the exact same way. All the four ports, port 0 to port 3, work the exact same way. So there are four parallel ports in 8051, port 0, port 1, port 2, and port 3. Each port consists of 8 bits, 0 to 7. 0th bit is called the least significant bit, and the 7th bit is called the most significant bit. That is pretty straightforward. Now, when it comes to parallel port operation, what I mean by parallel port operation? What are the ways in which the microcontroller communicates data parallelly? The word parallel means transferring data, whether it is transmitting or receiving, transferring data in a parallel fashion simultaneously. So if it is able to deliver data simultaneously in a similar instant of time, then we refer that as parallel port communication. Now, there are four ways in which our microcontroller can transmit and receive data parallelly. What are the types of parallel port operation? The first one is called pin write. Pin write means the microcontroller is writing a specific value in a particular pin. Let us say port 1.0. 1.0 is a unique pin in which I am writing some value. Writing means the data is flowing away from the microcontroller. It is flowing out. It is called pin write. The second type of parallel port operation is port write. What is port write? What do you mean by port? Port is nothing but group of pins. Okay, we have four such groups. What are they? Port 0, port 1, port 2, and port 3. So if you are going to write a value with a group of pins, then it will come under port write. Say for example, instead of writing a particular value in P1.0, I am writing an 8-bit value for the complete port 1. Port 1 means all 8 bits of port 1. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So the complete 8-bit value. This 8-bit value. That is called port write. Port means group of pins. So you can write a value to a particular pin, or you can write a value to a particular port. So this is called pin write and port write operation. The second, type of operation is pin read operation. What is pin read operation means? The microcontroller is reading a value from an external device. Okay, the external device is somewhere here. The microcontroller in this case is reading the value through a particular pin. Say for example, port 2.0. So this is called pin read operation, where the microcontroller is reading some information through a particular pin. The fourth class of operation is port read. Port read means I have a peripheral device where the microcontroller is reading 8-bit information from that particular device. Through one complete port, it is reading all the 8-bit values simultaneously. So this is pin read, where I am reading a value through a particular pin. This is called port read. Say for example, port 3. I am using one complete port for reading 8-bit value from an external device. These are the four possible parallel port operation in any microcontroller. Not only this microcontroller, any microcontroller. How will you write value? How will you write value to a particular pin? How do you write value to group of pins? How do you read value from a particular pin? And how do you read values from group of pins? This group of pins, we term it as a port. These are the four possible I/O operations of any parallel port. If you put any permutation and combination, any I/O operation of your microcontroller using parallel port will come under any of these four categories, nothing more than that. Let us see one by one and how to use them. Port write versus pin write. I already described very clearly what is the difference between port and a pin. When I say write, what do you mean by write? Write means the microcontroller is writing value. The microcontroller is sending some information out to a peripheral device. So if this is my microcontroller, if this is my peripheral, when I say write, the microcontroller is giving information to the peripheral device. This is what we mean by write. What is port write and what is pin write? Pin write means only a particular pin is used for writing information. Say for example, I am connecting a light emitting diode to port 2.7. So if the microcontroller is writing a value to that particular pin, then it is called pin write. Okay. What is port write? I am having a display device, say LCD. One full port, namely port 1, is used for supplying data to this LCD device. One complete port is used for writing data to this LCD device, then it comes under port write. So you understand the difference between port write and pin write. Pin write means only a single bit, any bit of a particular port is used for writing values. Port write means one complete port, the 8-bit complete port is used for writing values. So that is the difference between the two. Similarly, port read versus pin read. For clearly understanding the difference, it is better you understand through the peripheral devices what devices will come under pin write functionality. Can you please give me some examples of pin write loads, single bit loads? For example, one is light emitting diode, LED, light emitting diode. The second one comes under pin write is a buzzer, which is again a single bit output. The third single bit output can be a relay function. Okay, so these three will come under single bit outputs. That is why we call them as pin write functions. What are the port write peripherals? One is an LCD device. The second one is digital to analog converter. DAC, which will convert digital data into analog informations. All these things will come under port write operation, where we are writing 8-bit ports simultaneously. The other display device you can use is a 7-segment display. When I connect a 7-segment display, I use one complete port for delivering data. So all these peripheral devices will be using port write operations. Coming back to port read versus pin read, what are the peripheral devices which uses pin read functionality? The simple and straightforward one is a switch, a push button. All these switches will come under pin read functionality. Pin read functionality means you have a specific peripheral device connected to a particular pin like this. The data is flowing towards the microcontroller. The microcontroller is reading information in this case. How it is reading? It is using only one particular pin. That is why it is called pin read functionality. All single bit switching and all single bit inputs that are going to a microcontroller will come under this category, pin read functionality. What is port read? I use 8-bit port for reading information from a peripheral device. So here is a peripheral device where I connect this peripheral device to the AD, to the microcontroller, where one full port is used for reading data from the peripheral device to the microcontroller. What are those devices? Analog to digital converters, ADCs. In analog to digital converter, the microcontroller reads the 8-bit data from the ADC to the microcontroller. This is a port read operation. Okay, so you clearly understand what is the difference between port versus pin, read versus write. So parallel port operations can be read versus write. Read means the microcontroller accepts the data. Write means the microcontroller delivers the data. This is the difference between read versus write. The next one is pin versus port. Pin means the microcontroller accepts, the microcontroller accepts or delivers in a single pin. Port means the microcontroller accepts or deliver data using 7 down to 0 or 8 bits. One full port, say port 2, port 3 is used. So any parallel port combination, any parallel port operation will come under these four: pin read, pin write, port read and port write. Hope you understand the difference between pin versus port and read versus write. Okay, so let us discuss in detail all these four possible combinations for the today's class. First one is pin write operation. Pin write operation means the microcontroller supplies data to a peripheral device. So the data flows from the microcontroller to the load. So we use any particular pin of the available 8 pins of the microcontroller for our operation. In this case, I am using port 1.1. Port 1.1 is this pin. Okay, so you can use any of the available 8 pins for your operation. That is your pin write operation. How do we perform pin write operation? We use pin write operation using S bit variable. What is the declaration for that? S bit light emitting diode is connected to port 1 bit 1. The LED is equal to A1. LED is equal to 1 means the microcontroller will put 5 volts here. In this particular pin, the microcontroller will put 5 volt. LED equal to 0 means the microcontroller will substitute the value of this particular pin with 0 volts. As simple as that. So you understand what is pin write means. Pin write means I am using only single pin for writing value to a load. The load is a single bit load here. The second one is port write operation. Port write operation means I have a peripheral device. That peripheral device is connected with all 8-bit pins of a particular port. The data is this direction. The data is this direction. This can be analog to digital converter, ADC. Sorry, wrong. LCD display. Okay, so the microcontroller is writing data to an output device called LCD from the microcontroller to the load. Similar is the case for here. The peripheral device is connected with 8-bit load. In this case, it can be a 7-segment display. So all these things will come under port write operations. Pin read operation. The microcontroller is supplying data to the peripheral device is supplying data to the microcontroller in this case. So for port write, in the previous case, how do we write values? Port 2 is equal to hexadecimal 32. Port 1 is equal to hexadecimal FF. Port 3 is equal to hexadecimal D8. So we assign a value to the port. What is the syntax? Port equal to value. This is the syntax. Pin read. Pin read is, when I say pin, automatically you have to use S-bit variable. S-bit. My pin is assigned to port 1 cap 2. My pin is a variable. Now in this case, how do you read the value? You are reading a value from a pin, isn't it? So whenever the user is pressing a value, pressing the switch, that is assigned to pin 1.2, which we are giving a name as my pin. We can take decisions based on what is my pin. If my pin takes a value of 0, when the user is pressing the button, it takes a value of 0, then I do something. Buzzer is equal to 1. Else buzzer is equal to 0. This is pin read function. The moment I say pin, automatically you need to go for S-bit declaration. Fourth one is port read function. In port read function, one complete port is used for reading value from a peripheral device. This is where your ADC comes into picture. One full port is used for receiving data from the port. So how do we read values in this case? Port 2. In this case, port 2 carries information from the ADC, which we will assign it to a variable. So my data is equal to port 2. Port 2 information is assigned to a variable called my data. Temperature is equal to port 3. The information that is coming from port 3 is assigned to a variable called temperature. So we are reading port value and we are saving that information to a variable. Okay. So this is the four operations that we needed to understand. So I pause here and I get your inputs with regard to whether you are able to understand these four possible operations. There are only four possible operations that a microcontroller can do with regard to parallel port. Either it can read a pin or it can write a pin. Either it can read a port or it can write a port. Pin read, pin write, port read and port write. These are the four possible combinations. What kind of operation that you wanted to use depends upon the type of the peripheral. If the peripheral happened to be a input peripheral, we use read operation. If the peripheral happened to be a output peripheral, we use write operation. Depending upon whether it is a single bit peripheral or an 8-bit peripheral, we use either a pin or a port. So this is what is the logic behind it. Are you all with me? Yes. Now let us see some information with regard to pin read and pin write functionality. So yes, okay. Now let us start with pin write functionality. Pin write functionality means a microcontroller writes value to a load. When I say pin, it is a single bit pin. When I say write, it is an output. Okay, so nothing more than a light emitting diode could be used for this purpose. How can you connect a light emitting diode to a microcontroller? So I can connect a microcontroller directly to the positive of the light emitting diode like this. So if I connect the positive of the light emitting diode to a parallel port pin like this, if you apply plus 5 volt here, the LED turns on. If you apply 0 volt here, the LED goes off. So applying plus 5 volt will make the light emitting diode to go on. Applying 0 volt here means this is already grounded. So there is no potential difference between the two and the light emitting diode cannot glow here. So this is one way of connecting a microcontroller with a light emitting diode. There is also another way of connecting the same, where the microcontroller is connected with the negative of the light emitting diode. In this case, the positive of the light emitting diode is connected to power supply through a resistor R. Negative of the light emitting diode is connected to the port pin. This is port 1.0. Now, this light emitting diode will now glow only when I apply 0 here. Unlike here, a 0 turns the LED off. Here, a 0 in the port pin will turn the LED on. What is the physics behind it? Because a 0 here will create potential difference. One end of the LED is already connected with 5 volt. Only when I make a 0 here, which means this negative point is connected to ground, there can be current flow, there can be a potential difference, and there can be a current flow, and hence the LED can glow. So here, writing a 0 will make the LED to glow, whereas making this one to plus 5 volt will not have any potential difference, and hence the LED is off here. So there are two ways in which you can connect a light emitting diode to a microcontroller. Either the positive of the light emitting diode can be connected to the pin and the negative can be grounded. In that case, it is a positive logic where the light emitting diode is turned on by supplying a 5 volt here and turned off by supplying a 0 volt here. The second way of connecting a light emitting diode to a microcontroller is by using reverse logic or by syncing, where the negative of the light emitting diode is connected to the port pin and the positive is connected to power supply. In this case, supplying 0 will turn the LED on because a 0 here will create a potential difference and hence the light emitting diode gets turned on. And supplying a 5 volt here will make the potential difference becomes 0 and hence that light emitting diode goes off. Okay, so this is where the concept of sourcing and syncing comes. Of the two techniques, the first technique is called sourcing. Why it is called sourcing? The microcontroller sources the current to the light emitting diode. I am connecting positive of the light emitting diode to the microcontroller. The negative of the light emitting diode is connected to ground. This is called sourcing. Sourcing. Why it is this? Let us say this is port 1.0. Why it is called sourcing? The microcontroller port pin is supplying the necessary current for the light emitting diode to go on. So the microcontroller sources current. The second technique where I use the same port 1.0, but in this case, I am connecting the negative of the light emitting diode to port 1.0 and the positive of the light emitting diode is connected to power supply. This is called sinking. Why this is called sinking? This is called sinking because in this case, the power supply is sourcing the current and the current is getting synced into the microcontroller. It is getting into the microcontroller. The microcontroller sinks the current. Okay? So what is the difference between sourcing and sinking? When the microcontroller is sourcing current, there is no way that it can source beyond its capability. A microcontroller can source a current of maximum of 10 to 15 milliamps per pin. I'm talking about the maximum value, which means there is no way a microcontroller pin can supply a current beyond this value, which means this load is always safe. Because a current value of 10 to 15 milliamps is not going to harm this device. So this device is always safe when the microcontroller is sourcing it, because there is no way that the microcontroller is going to source a current beyond this value. And this current value is pretty safe for this particular load. Therefore, the device is pretty safe. Coming back here, who is sourcing the current in this case? It is the power supply which sources the current, and the microcontroller is sinking or receiving the current in this case. And if you see the sourcing capability of the power supply can theoretically source infinite current, which means it can keep on supply a very large amount of current through this load. And if you don't take any precautionary measure so as to what should be the maximum current that can flow through this circuit, this power supply can kill this load in no time. That is the reason why, if you see this particular circuit is having a resistor here, or whereas this is not having any resistor through this circuit, R is not present here, whereas a current limiting resistor is present in this circuit. Why? Because I am making sure that this circuit current is not exceeding 10 milliamps or 15 milliamps depending upon my requirement, and design this value of R so that the circuit current is not going to exceed beyond 10 milliamps. Because in this case, my power supply is sourcing the current, and the microcontroller is sinking. So if you don't take any precautionary measure, the power supply can supply excess current and kill this load. So how do I calculate this R? Yeah, so this is a simple RC circuit. I have a resistor, I have a light emitting diode. The other end is connected to the ground, let us say. So this is R, this is power supply of 5 volt. This is the forward voltage of the diode. When the diode is fully on, let us say it takes 2 volt. So what is the current that you want this circuit to take? Say 10 milliamps. So the current in this circuit is equal to, what is the Kirchhoff's voltage law of this circuit? 5 volt is equal to I times R plus the forward voltage of the diode. So I times R is equal to 5 minus of forward voltage of the diode. In this case, diode means light emitting diode, which is 2, for example. So it is 3. So I into R takes 3. I have already fixed it as 10 milliamps here. So the value of R should be 3 divided by 10 milliamps. So 3 divided by 10, this milliamps goes up becomes 3000, which will roughly give you 300 ohms. So I put a value of 300 ohms here to make sure that the circuit current is not exceeding 10 milliamps. This precaution is necessary only in sinking, not in sourcing. So this difference you have to understand very clearly. Okay. I think I have crossed the time limit. Is it okay? We will continue the remaining in the next class or? Yeah. So I stop here for time being. We'll take this discussion.